Okay, I think we're on now. So, welcome, Reni. Thank you so much for being here with us this afternoon. I will, so the we are broadcasting from Esade in Caldas da Rainha, and Reni is in Barcelona, in her house in Barcelona. And so we have in this room, in this virtual room of Zoom with us, so the students of the third year and the second year of industrial design, but also the students of the master's on product design are already here or will join us in this afternoon. So welcome again, Reni, and thank you. These sessions that we've been doing, Design for Debate, I think this is our third edition that Teresa Fradique and I share here at ESAD. Unfortunately, last year it was canceled because of the pandemics and because of what everything happens. And usually we are a small school. We don't have the resources to bring all the guests that we bring. So usually we have a more intimacy conversation in the Design for Debate. We welcome the guests here at ESAD. But this year we didn't want to, of course, cancel again. And we thought, wait, let's take advantage of this horrible situation that we are all living in, and let's invite names from our bibliography, the most important references that we give to our students for the contemporary design, how it is being shaped now. So we have these conversations with five guests during the semester, and the first one is a very important figure of how all the contemporary, I think this is really my opinion, how all the contemporary design that you see now, the way that even you learn in school here is shaped. So Reni and Drog brought to the world of of design the not she broke this line where you had to respond to aesthetical things and to think on a more conscious idea. But to present her, we ask our students to prepare a presentation of Reni. So I will put Daniela spotlighted, and she will make a short, a brief introduction of Reni. Let's see what they studied.
Good afternoon. My name is Daniela, and I have the immense honor to present you Reni Hamakers. Today, we have the pleasure to talk with one of the most remarkable names in the world of design. Reni trained as an art historian and has become a curator, critic, concept developer, and lecturer. She worked with innumerable artists, designers, architects, writers, but also magazines and companies in different parts of the world. In 93, alongside with Rhys Baker, she created the so famous Dutch company, known for making original design and working with already existing products and materials by giving them a completely different and interesting approach. Reni is particularly known for her capacity to develop very original and impactful perspectives, for collaborating with a great diversity of cultures, and for believing in design as a way to create social change. Our mantra can be resumed in the challenge, rethink everything, and always see opportunity instead of a problem. The book recently published by Aaron Betsky with the title Reni Hamakers, Rethinking Design, is resumed online this way. Reni Hamakers is realizing projects that combine virtual technologies and social media with the craft of design to develop new social relations. For more than three decades, the Dutch art historian, critic, and curator has been influencing the nature and purpose of design. As co-founder of Troupe Design Collective, she has championed the notion of furniture and industrial design as a rethinking of today's world. When Droog first exhibited at the Milan Furniture Fair in 1993, its assemblies of found materials and witty forms instantly changed the landscape of design. Since then, Hamakers has worked with the makers and creators to move beyond sleek objects and towards critical projects that open our eyes to our multifaceted realities while offering easy access and great joy to users. We won't have time today to go as deep as Aaron Betsky went in his book, but we hope that you can share with us your experience and give us your wise knowledge to help us be designers who can change consciences because we cannot change the world. Welcome, Reni. It's such a pleasure to have you here. And thanks for taking the time to be with us.
Thank you for this beautiful story. You can tell it better than me. What can I say?
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Oh, there's also a slideshow.
It's a very, very brief slideshow. We selected Marcia here, gave us a very good assistance. Thank you, Marcia, student of master's degree. And so we did a very a simple story of what we found. The base to talk a bit about your involvement in design, but also then to go to the students' questions, their own that they want to know lots of things. So I hope we have some time. But it's important to contextualize because only a small group in the class did this deep research on your work. And of course, you were probably expecting this image of Theo Remy. But it's nice when we were putting it in this slideshow. It's an image. The Theo Remy chest of drawers is from 1991, and maybe it's 2 years before Droog first appeared in Milan. So maybe you can tell us this story on how this chest of drawers 1991 and then Milan in 93.
Yes, with pleasure. This in product is indeed from 1991. He graduated at the design school in Utrecht, Theo Remy. And in that period, I was looking around I was discovering all kinds of innovative design. Design what had something to tell me rather than aesthetics and function. This was a design that tells a story. And at that time, I was collecting all kinds of design to present in my personal presentations. That was before Droog. And why I found this design so important, because it tells quite a few stories. It tells a story of our overconsumption, our overproduction. Can you imagine there are so many designers at this moment now working on reuse of products? And this designer did it already in 1991. He was taking old drawers, 20 old drawers, and he took them as they were. Some have a label on it still, and others are damaged. It didn't matter. He just took them as it were, as he found them. And he stacked them and then strapped a belt around it. And that's the whole cupboard. And at that time, the official designers were not happy at all. And they said, this is not designing. There is no construction. If you open the belt, all the drawers are falling on the floor and you have to build it again. And the designer said, yes, that's exactly what I mean. This is improvisation. And for him, design was too strict, too rigid. There was no user intervention. In this design, you can put your own drawers in if you want. I know a person who also put her TV in it. So this is a very, very open design. And this design told me so many stories that I hadn't heard before.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of the first products I found on my path in looking for a new vision in design. And at that time, I was editor-in-chief of a design magazine. Mm-hmm. And I became bored, and I by all these designs were look like each other.
Mm-hmm.
When I went to Milan to the furniture fair, I found the same kind of chairs in metal, in plastic, in wood, but there was no concept, no storytelling. And so then suddenly in 1991, I found these kind of designs and I collected them because it's not me who started Droog. Yes, I started Droog together with Gijs Bakker, but the designs were already there and I brought it together and I gave it an overall story. And that's what I did.
But it was very difficult to find a way to produce, to create an edition line of this kind of design, right? You struggled a bit with that in the beginning. So if you wanted to sell this design,
It depends what you want. Mm-hmm. For instance, this product is a unique item. Mm-hmm. Every chest is different because you have to find 20 different drawers. So we sell them as unique items. But we also, after a few years, we also started to collaborate. The second year, we started to collaborate with someone who could produce and develop these products. Mm-hmm. And for some products, it's quite difficult to produce them because they are not designed as an industrial designer does.
Mm-hmm.
These are very young designers. Mm-hmm. They just graduated and they had an idea. They had a vision and they wanted to present this vision make it into a product. And they didn't think of technical restrictions. They didn't think of how can I sell them for a reasonable price? No, they wanted to make a statement.
Yeah.
And it's very important. And I saw one of the questions of the students about young designers, if they are more open-minded maybe. And I think, yes, I think if you are young designers, you have to be open-minded. You have to, that's the moment you can do, you can follow your own instincts and maybe be innocent, be naive. But because when you are 20, 30 years farther, you know all the restraints, you know the restrictions, and then it's very difficult to come with something totally new. I think it's a challenge for young designers to do what they want to do and even go against the wishes of the teacher. I remember, you know, Piet Hein Eek, who did the scrapwood chest. He was also one of our first designers and he designed taught to make aesthetic products, to make things that really look nice. Mm-hmm. Beautiful finishing, beautiful materials. And he showed his teachers that he could make a cupboard made of the ugliest material he could find, scrap wood. Mm-hmm. And so that's what he showed. To the teacher, okay, I am taught to make things very precise and very beautiful. Mm-hmm. And I show you that it also can be beautiful if you don't do that. And because he did it in such a convincing way, and this product became famous. Mm-hmm. And so you make a new step. By not only, of course, you have to follow your teacher. Your teacher can teach you a lot of things, but the teacher cannot teach you your mindset. Mm-hmm. You have to follow also your own intuition and your own mindset. And it's a balance between the two.
You never, that was a question that I had. You never, so how you were writing about design in a design magazine at this time. Mm-hmm. So how did you meet with this young designer, with Teo or with all the other designers that you took to Milan in 1993?
Before Milan, I had a show in Paradiso, the Amsterdam Rock Club, and I saw some designs at exhibitions, in publications, but also I worked with some designers who brought me other young designers. So the designers I chose, they also knew other designers. So together we could create a whole bunch of designs in the same spirit. And then I met Gijs Bakker, who became my partner. And he had plans to go to Milan. He was teaching at the Design Academy in Eindhoven. And he wanted to go with his students. And I had my own collection. And then it turned out that it was overlapping. And so we had almost the same kind of ideas. And I found some designers he didn't know. And he found some designers I didn't know. So that's how Milan came.
All together, and it was a huge
put it together in 6 weeks,
and history says how it came out. It was a wonderful. So but Gijs was a professor. You were never a professor. You gave lots of classes like this, but you were never a professor in the university, right?
I have been teaching with him together at a master's course at the Design Academy for 5 or 6 years, I think. But okay. I'm not, I'm more a thinker, writer, creator, and I'm not so fond of teaching. I don't know why, but it's not my first love.
Okay.
I have to talk with you, but not every week.
Yeah, it's overwhelming, just teaching.
No, I don't know. I did some workshops and I found it tough. I don't know why, but I found it tough to do this. Yes. It's not my.
But it's the
Notte chair, Marcel Wanders. Yes, also very interesting because in the beginning in Milan we showed products. So the first year we had this collection of products. The second year we found more products. Third year we found more products. And then I was afraid that it should stop. And I thought I have to initiate projects. Mm-hmm. I have to push the designers to create something different. Mm-hmm. And this was my first project, DryTech called. And I did this together with the aerospace laboratory at the Technical University in Delft. And they had all these high-tech fibers which are used in airplanes, and but do not have an aesthetic. Nobody knows how at that time, nobody knew how carbon fiber looks, or glass fiber. And that was the task I gave to the group of designers who worked in this project. Try to combine a craftsman's approach to high-tech materials so that we can see high-tech materials in a different way instead of being functional. Mm-hmm. But give them also a face. And this is the most famous product from this project. Yes. And well, Marcel Wanders knotted, which is a very macrame, do you know macrame? Old technique.
Yes.
And, he knotted with the high-tech fibers. Mm-hmm. And so this chair came. And it's very light and very strong.
And until this moment, so this was the first project that you initiated, not only just looking for, but until this moment, you were working mainly with Dutch designers, right? The Netherlands. Or it was...
I think around this time, the first foreign designer was Martí Quixé from Barcelona. Mm-hmm. And that was already around this time, after a few years, I think in 1997 or something like that, yeah.
But this intentionally joining, because then Drog in the years to come, it will use this idea lots and lots of times of going, joining these almost crafts techniques like macrame and high-tech materials. It was something that was in your interest yeah. of already looking for crafts to yeah. produce.
I was at that time writing an article about I was writing an editorial for the magazine mm-hmm. about the content of the magazine, and there was person who wrote an article about innovative Japanese textiles. And then I asked myself the question, and also the question in this editorial, what would happen if we combine craft and technology? Mm-hmm. And that was something I was curious about. So I started this project because I was curious.
Okay. And I think now we talk a lot about this, and in Portugal, as you can imagine, we talk a lot about how we should go back to the crafts and work with this
crafts. Yeah, but it's not that I want to go back to the crafts. It's more that at that moment I wanted to see how you could create an identity for these materials that nobody has seen. Mm-hmm. Normally, and how you can do this by approaching it as a craftsman. I give you an example in Hella Jongerius, mm-hmm. to knit with these fibers, and she in the university, the technicians, they design everything with the computer. Mm-hmm. And she wanted to knit, really knitting, and then put it in the fire and to see, to harden, it was a lamp, and to see how it would react. And so her pieces, it started by burning and damaging. And she in this project, it was never a complete... how do you say this? There was always something wrong with the product. And and then the technician said, how stupid, you can calculate this in the computer. Why don't you do this? And she said, no, I want this intuitive, I want to discover myself what's mm-hmm. happening when I put it in the oven and see like a ceramist. Mm-hmm. And it was good for her own development, but it was also good for the product. And it could, this product is produced by Capellini, mm-hmm. but her lamp, she made finally two or three, and it's in the Museum of Modern Art in New York, is one and another museum, and that's it. But that's a very good experience. And for me, sometimes a product doesn't need to end into a finished product.
Yeah, it could be just this strong idea or the cultural relation that it will give to the...
Cultural value. And so that other designers can be inspired by it and mm-hmm. also a designer who does it, who does the job. It's good. It's if you, and that's the difference between, I think, a lot of industrial designers, who are designing and calculating something and know if I do this then that and if I do that, and or a designer who is naive and say, okay, I want to experience myself what is going on. And of course, Helion Gerich is now an experienced designer, so it's a different story now, but that, I think that was very important when you are a young designer to do things which are unusual.
Mm-hmm. But there is one thing that you did at the time when you were selecting objects for draw collection or for exhibitions or for the curatorial work you did, is that you always tried to select objects that had use, so that they wouldn't be. Now you have a curatorial path in visual arts, so we'll talk a bit about that too, hopefully. But so at the time for Drog, it was very important that they were usable in terms of.
I didn't want to present a cup with no bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it should be usable, and maybe not always in a very decent way, but it should be used, and it should also do more than to be used. It is also a kind of mentally use. For instance, we had this this doorbell with the two wine glasses, and when you push the button, the little hammer is touching the glass, and it says ding dong, and it you can use it. I use it in my own home, but. Mm-hmm. By looking at it and experiences, there is much more about it. You see, everyone who is seeing this thing is like, oh, wow, what is this? So nice. And then they see the ding dong, and then everyone starts smiling. And yeah, it's just more than a functional product.
We'll go to a bit more to that. Of course, Jürgen Bay, a bit later, it was also a very important reference. In Drog.
Yeah. I have been working with him a lot. Mm-hmm. This is a project we did in Oranienbaum in Germany, 1999, yes. And it was a castle, a Dutch royal heritage. And in the castle has a big garden, and his philosophy was to bring classic chair backs, as you can find them in the castle, and a fallen tree. And for him, a fallen tree, you can sit on a fallen tree, you don't need a bench. Yeah. But of course, he wanted to do more, and he wanted to make a connection with the cultural heritage. So that's why this product came into existence, the bags cast in bronze and stacked in the tree. Hills, very simple. Yeah, this is Up. Up was, that was in 2000. I started with this in 2009, the start of the economic crisis. Yeah. And I read in a newspaper that every month 500 companies went bankrupt. Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh, what are they doing with their stock? And I went to a waste processing company, and I talked with the director, and he said, every day we destroy tons of brand new products because companies are going bankrupt. So that's why I created Up, and to see how we can redesign that stock and to give them a new life, mm-hmm. and to bring them again in circulation. And I did this with six companies, And we had a symposium, and there were all kinds of design. The tray on wheels was an ordinary tray, like you use them in canteens. And now it's funny products. And the elephant is based on material products of the company producing medical appliances.
Mm-hmm.
And this, the cup and saucers with text on it, which makes you think. The project was very successful, except that the five companies didn't want to go on. And the only company who wanted to collaborate with us after the project was the waste processing company.
Mm-hmm.
And these five companies are not small companies. Some are very big, and they are targeted to a mass market.
Mm-hmm.
And our designers didn't think of the market.
Yeah.
Yes, those designers don't do that. So it was impossible for them to sell our products to their customers.
Mm-hmm.
Far too expensive, far too not mediocre at all. But the waste processing company wanted to work with us. And then it happened that they phoned us and they say, we have 200 car tires.
Mm-hmm.
And where can I leave them so mm-hmm. that you can redesign them? And then I became totally upset because I have no place to leave 200 for car tires of 20,000 perfume bottles.
Yes. So, Reni, I have, as you might notice in this presentation, we have this big jump from Jürgen Bay in time to a project where you were nominated as one of the most influential because of the project. And so the Teo Remy Chest of Drawers was already somehow telling us about this waste. In 1990, nobody was speaking about climate change or anything. And some of these projects that Drawer was already raising consciousness for reusing common materials or common objects. Not with this, I don't think it was with an environmental question, because in 1991, no one was really thinking about it. We didn't knew about it, but it already said we can reuse these objects, junior stuff about it. And then in 2011, there's an economic crisis. There's also an idea of recycling or ecological idea behind these objects, I believe. So, but this, in the meantime, what I feel is that during all this time, we lost part of our humor, because it is so serious for the planet what is going on. And these young designers that we have here with us, sometimes when we look at, for instance, at Paradiso, at exhibitions, the students probably don't know Paradiso in Amsterdam is a very famous and notorious nightclub. And or we look now to these times where the responsibility of designing sustainable and caring objects for the planet that do us good, everything, it takes out part of the fun in a way. So how do you, as a curator, as an editor, director of Drog, deal with this, with all the humor that you had and the fun you had with the Drog, or you just don't try not to think too much about it?
No, I think in my whole Drog life,
mm-hmm.
I have been addressing serious problems.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that that it is just a funny mm-hmm. object. It's about certain problems. If it is about destroying that stock or living alone or contact, we did this, me, myself and you, how you make contact with others. And you can do this in a playful way. If you redesign that stock, you can make a product playful. And I think that you can address all those serious problems. You can also, I believe that you can also do this in with some playfulness or with some irony. Of course, that's well, again, it's all the projects I've done, we're addressing some problem and some issue.
So you don't feel that the world is trying to make us more dark and serious about this? Yes, you have your...
No, it's true. The world is making us to feel things, to become very dark and serious. And I have to save the climate. And I think that a designer cannot save the climate. A designer can do a little thing. A designer can do this also in a playful way. And a designer can also help to bring awareness. And can also do this in a playful or ironical way. Or in a beautiful way. Creating sustainable products which really look beautiful instead of looking, oh, they are looking so sustainable. Oh, look how sustainable. No, I want to see a beautiful product. And then it turns out to be sustainable. But first, as a consumer, I want to see a beautiful product, what I want to buy.
It's true. I agree. So, Henny, we have lots of slides more. I think we don't have time to go through all of them in detail because the students really want to speak to with you, and this is supposed to be a conversation between you and them and not me. So I will come out of scene very, very soon. I would maybe just put the slides to see some of the projects we would like you to talk a bit. And maybe you can...
The previous one. Yeah, this is about what I said. Okay, how can people make contact to each other? And these designers made these fences. And fences in which you can play a ping pong with your neighbor, or you share products for your garden utensils. And I think this is a serious product. But it's also very playful. Nobody had thought about it at that time. So this is what I mean. You can do things in a boring way, or you can do it with some playfulness, lightness.
And sometimes this could reach more because people get involved in it. It invites people in a nicer way than if you're too tough with the.
Yeah. My experience is that all our presentations, people left our presentation with a smile.
Yeah.
They recognize things because these fences are ordinary fences. It's not a designed fence. It's just an ordinary fence.
You recognize them from your place, from the places you live in.
From the place where you buy these things. And it's just the intervention which make people smile.
True. So lots of incredible things. Of course, we put it Identity Land. Also with this partnership with Section 33, we will have Jan Bolen already, he's not already anymore in Z33, but he will be with us here in May 5. So it's very important. And I truly believe that all the work that the curators are doing now in terms of design, was not possible without that exhibition 93 that of Drog, how it was presented. Because maybe you can go a bit on this, on how do you feel?
About to design a coin, a euro coin, and you see only your own face in it as a mirror.
Yes, I see.
It's so nice. It's so beautiful.
And so it should be like this. Every citizen of Europe should see their face in the...
Yeah. So an individual coin.
It's really beautiful. So now we come to your last project, right?
Not my last. This is 2 years ago.
2 years. So, but it was part of Ngola Biennale, no?
No, I curated the whole Biennale.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not part. This was part of the Biennale, but I curated the whole Biennale. Yeah.
No. And in Saint-Thomé, in principle.
Yeah. Well, connected to Portugal, eh? Yeah.
Yes, of course. And that, how do you how did this relation appeared, and how did you come to this? Curating an art biennale in a country like Saint-Thomé with this cultural relation, how did it happen? Can you tell us?
Long story short, I did a project in Cape Town,
mm-hmm.
and there was a guy from the embassy. And he knew another guy who was working in Sao Tome, and mm-hmm. they wanted, there is a cultural center, mm-hmm. and they asked us to redesign the cultural center. And based on what you can find on the island, because in Cape Town, everything was based on found materials. And they wanted us to do the same. And so I did, together with my team. And then the question came about this Biennale. And the Biennale hadn't been on for 6 or 4 years, I think. And they wanted to revive it. And I said, okay, I want to help. And now, and finally, I became the curator for one time. And I wanted to make Sao Tome, the Biennale of Sao Tome, an international hotspot.
Indeed.
And so I invited artists from the whole of Africa, the whole continent, to mm-hmm. come over and to also with performances. This is a performance by Sunny Dolat from Kenya. And it was really, really a fantastic experience. And when I started, I didn't know anything about African art, I must say. And the first I went to Evora, and in Evora there was an exhibition about African art.
Oh, okay.
And I found my first artist. And then when you have your first artist and your second, then you come acquainted with many more, and then you know what you are going to do. But in Evora, I found the first artist.
Good. So you had the chance to use your knowledge of Portuguese in Saint-Thomé? No.
I don't know anything about Portuguese. The language, you mean?
Yes.
I can read it, because when I read it, I see that it's close to Spanish. I can read Spanish and I can Portuguese, yes. But speaking, impossible.
Impossible. Well, as you know, we talked a bit about in the back about this.
Yeah.
So, Fernando Brizio is your Portuguese. You should have learned a bit. I don't know if Fernando is here. He would try to pop in. He's assembling an exhibition in Lisbon. But so this was the first project that your professor, the professor of these students, showed together with you in Milan in the Dry Kitchen. It's very difficult to get in 2001. And now, since 2010, the what you see is not that was.
It's so beautiful. It's a sticker for the people who don't know it. It's a sticker, the whole thing, and it's only a drawer. And the drawer is sticked against the sticker. And I have it in my house, and but I must say, nobody bought it. We had it in our shop. Nobody bought it. I don't know why. It's so beautiful. It's based on such a basic idea. You only need the drawer. The rest you can, is only visual.
And Henny, how did you select this object? So how do you come to these designers? Do they come to you? So how do you get to these objects today? Not in the beginning, we know already, but even today or in the past years, how do you say, okay, I'll take this object to Drog, to be edited by Drog?
No reasoning. I see an object, I think, wow, this is something what I should present. There is no reason at all. It's intuitive. Many during lectures, they are asking me, can you tell me how you select? I don't know. It should attract me in a way that I have here. I was so struck by the basic idea of only showing a drawer and the rest is just a picture. Yeah. And so many products are only a picture, and this is a picture you can use. So this is for me the story, and yeah.
Definitely.
How it works in my head.
So let me take some time to give voice to our students. João, you know, you collected the questions of your colleagues.
Yeah.
So tell us, what would you like to know from Reni?
So hello, Reni. First of all, hello. My name is João. Yeah, it's such a pleasure to be able to talk with you. So I have a few questions for you, if you don't mind. The first one is, you talked a bit about this project here, the Nangol exhibition. And knowing that you have a lot of experience working with lots of different cultures, like that project that I've referred and the Russian costumes, from all those experiences, that which ones gave you the most fulfillment? And also, what was so special about those projects that marked you the way they did?
That's a lot of questions. First, why I did do this? Because I thought I can learn from other cultures. And I was spotting locations with something special, which I thought, which can also be useful for our culture, for our life. For instance, in New York, when I there was a period I was very often in New York, and I was struck by this service economy. So there is the people create their own jobs, and they walk with dogs, and they help you to move your furniture. They help you with this or with that, and I found that very inspiring. And so not being without a job, sitting at home, but trying to make something and to create a new job. And I all those projects I did with partners. I sought partners in all those different countries, because I cannot just go there and say, let's do a project here. I need someone who is based there. So I did, in this case, I did it with the architects, Dilla Scofidio Renfro. And so they were my partners in this project. And they proposed to do this project in Levittown. And Levittown is one of many boring suburbs you have in the United States, post-war suburbs. And in this neighborhood, the streets are white The houses are at a certain distance from each other. There is no activity, only houses and streets. And for everything you want to do, you need a car. And so the idea was to bring in each house, to bring in an activity which it was also a neighborhood with an economic decline. So we wanted to bring in economic activity in each house so that people could earn money and also have more contact with the neighbors. And there is more activity in the streets. And so we did. We found 11 homeowners prepared to work with us. And we had an event for one day. And why only one day? Because you can't get a permit for this only if you do it as an art project and say we do it in one day. And this is what we did. And for me, to answer your other question, is one of the projects that became very rewarding for me. Because I saw these, when as soon as I see people enjoying themselves, having fun, there was an 82-year-old lady, and she was very lonely. And she lived there alone in this big house, and we created an attention clinic for her. So people could come to her with their problems and tell them their problems, and she would give them attention. And at a certain moment, she was telling her problems to the visitors. And she wrote me an email that she had enjoyed it so much, getting all those visitors who wanted to talk with her. And so that's very rewarding for me. If I see people enjoying themselves.
And also, was there any situation taking into consideration that you have a lot of knowledge with all those different cultures? Was there any situation where it really shocked you, all the cultural diversity?
No.
It didn't.
I see your question. And
I've
really been thinking about this, and I cannot come with something. No.
You are very open-minded.
Yeah. And of course, there have been issues, but not because I was, there have been issues, but they were not important for the project.
Of course.
Are also always issues, also in our own country. There's always, you work with people, there's always issues.
Exactly. Another question referring all those different countries. Knowing that the Netherlands and other countries like Germany and Italy are very well known for in the design industry and industrial design. What are the countries more peripheral? Do you consider having a high level of applications in product and industrial design? And the second question is, where do you think Portugal is at comparing to all those countries?
What was the first question? Sorry.
I was asking, what other countries more peripheral do you consider having a high level of industrial design applications like Germany and Italy?
Yeah, and what is the question? I don't understand the question.
Italy and Germany are very well known for industrial design, yes. Right?
Yeah.
Do you consider other countries that we don't know about that also have a high level of industrial design?
Industrial design or industrial production? I think Japan, for instance, has also quite a tradition in industrial design.
And where do you think Portugal stands at? Do you think Portugal? Sorry.
Yeah, go on, please.
Sorry. Where do you think Portugal stands at comparing to those countries? Do you think we are becoming more and more known for our design. And what do you think about that?
It's very difficult for me to judge because what I know about industrial design is what I see in exhibitions, on fairs, or in magazines, or at conferences. Mm-hmm. And there used to be the Experimenta design event in Portugal, and that was a very famous event. I even proposed the city of Amsterdam to bring it to Amsterdam. And I also gave a talk at Experiment, and I knew there was an exhibition and also about Portuguese design. And I think this is very, very important to promote the design of your country, design, and not only design in general, but also design of Portugal. Because all those initiatives of bringing an international event, they always include also the local, what's happening locally. And I'm missing that at this moment.
You miss design events?
Okay.
I miss these, yeah, there are design events, but if you are asking about Portugal, I miss something like Experimenta.
Okay. So we have, João, we only have 3 minutes with Reni. So I will just ask Teresa. Teresa, where are you? I lost you in the middle of all these squares.
Hi, I'm here.
Sorry. So Teresa, is there any question put into our chats in the YouTube? Because Teresa was checking that we should...
Not really new questions. So if we have time for one last question from João, it's okay, Reni.
Filipe Alarcão is here, Renato is here, Paulo is here. I don't know. It's very stressful, Reni, to this moment of last question. Everyone is nervous. Don't forget to take off your microphones to speak. No.
No questions.
Well,
I would like to thank the presence of Reni and to say that for me, Druk design, I was in my 20s when in the 90s. So it was really, really inspiring at the moment. And it changed the way I understand design, and probably it changed the way I teach design. And maybe I would like to ask you, what do you think that in our decade now, in our 20s, these 20s, do you have any advice to our students that you can give to be like, I know that Carla spoke about this humor, and you spoke about this like lightness of designing, but what do you think that could inspire the young designers for like this art task of making meaningful products and inspiring products?
I would say be open-minded and just be innocent and don't think of I don't know enough. No, it's an advantage that you don't know enough. Mm-hmm. And in this stage of your life, you should be really open-minded. And don't lose playfulness, and don't design useless products. So design something which is useful for the planet, useful for work, or useful for hospitals or whatever, useful in the house, but do it with some lightness. And that will make people happy.
Very, very important. So I will all ask you to take your microphones out and give a big, big thank you to Reni. Reni, we had tons of questions, as you know, because you got them. So you know that we have lots of conversation to have. So you are already invited as soon as this lockdown goes out. You're very close. Come and see us and visit your friends in Caldas de Rainha. We will welcome you anytime you want and meet all these people in person. And I hope we meet somewhere soon around without this lockdown. And thank you again, Reni. And let's give a big thank you to Reni.
Thanks, Reni.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you.